Rumor has it that Once Upon a Time in Hollywood is Quentin Tarantino's final film. If this is his swan song, is it a worthy send-off?
For our review today of Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, we are welcoming Carlos Corral as our special guest. He is a local filmmaker and the director of the El Paso Film Festival. And you can definitely find more information about the El Paso Film Festival at elpasofilmfestival.org coming up in October, right?
October 2019.
All right.
Set your calendars, everybody.
Hey guys, thanks for watching the review for Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. Stick around till the end of the video. Comment in the section below for your chance to win two tickets to the Alamo Drafthouse to watch any movie you want. And of course, we recommend Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. So, what did you guys think of the movie?
My initial takeaway from that movie was that if this is Quentin Tarantino's swan song, then this swan is going to fly away with a little bit of a gimpy wing, as far as I'm concerned. I don't know about you guys.
Really? I thought it was a great fairy tale.
I thought it was a great satire on Hollywood. For me, it's not strictly, you know, it's not a masterpiece. It's not Quentin Tarantino's best film, but it's pretty high up there for me because I thought that it was very humorous, and for that reason, it was kind of a fresh take on a Tarantino film, because Tarantino films, as we know, tend to be hyper-violent and crazy.
Frenetically paced.
Yeah, and we do get a little bit of that in this film, but this is absolutely funny, like, throughout.
A little bit. Of course, it always has a violent ending. No spoilers here, but there is a violent ending.
There is a violent ending.
Yeah, you know, Quentin Tarantino, you're going to have something at the end. I mean, this, to me, wasn't a horrible movie. It just wasn't as good as some of the other ones that I've been used to, and so it's not, like, the greatest send-off I've ever seen.
Well, this also is not his final movie. Remember, he's either going to do Star Trek or something different.
But is he, though? That's still kind of...
I don't know, but he is going to make a 10th movie, so this
is not the end. You're just hopeful that he's going
to... Allegedly.
This is not the end.
We have a great cast and great surprises, by the way. Like, Lena Dunham was in this, and...
Everybody was in this. Michael Madsen, it was great.
Oh, yeah, I love Luke Perry.
If you guys didn't check this, but Mr. Martin Crowe was also in it.
Yeah, Bruce Dern, by the way.
Bruce Dern was in it, too.
Dad.
So, it's a fantastic cameo.
And that's what I love about Tarantino films is that the more films he makes and the more actors he works with, you almost want to see which actors are going to come back for the next ones, because there is no small role in a Quentin Tarantino movie.
Yeah. How did you guys feel about the pacing of the film?
Well, this film was about, 3 hours long?
It was like 2 hours and 45 minutes or so.
Give or take some time. The pacing for me, I'm used to a lot of action, so for me, it dragged out a few points. I mean, I know you talked about those points having some meaning behind it.
Right, because you mentioned the Margot Robbie scenes were kind of a waste a little bit, right?
For me, it was.
I kind of felt that her character was a little bit like, I don't know, they didn't focus too much on developing her character. She was just kind of there to develop a little bit of these themes about, you know, how Hollywood is kind of like this underbelly town where dreams don't always come true, you know? And especially with her, she's like a B-movie, you know, actress.
Well, you guys have to remember what actually did happen to Sharon Tate in real life.
Okay.
So, yes, at the time she was a B-movie, but, you know, as this film kind of goes into it, it's what was the day in the life of someone like Sharon Tate, who was a B-movie? Yeah, you're right, it wasn't glamorous.
It wasn't glamorous. Right.
She was dating a big director at the time, you know, so it's, you know, what's going on? You know, she's going to have a baby. It's like, okay, it's going to be family life, I guess.
Again,
if you know the true story of what happened, then you kind of think, I like this character, I like where she's going, but will it end the way real life did?
And we all know that Tarantino likes his historical fiction, right?
So,
without giving anything away.
But hence, Once Upon a Time in Hollywood.
Right.
This is a Hollywood fairy tale.
I totally get how this is kind of a slice of her life. It's you know, you roll her into the movie because what she goes through has relevance to the context of the movie. But for me, I appreciated more of the Leonardo DiCaprio and Brad Pitt of the movie. I wanted more of that. Some of this whole Charlie Manson and Sharon Tate side plot to me was distracting. I didn't really care that much for it. I didn't feel like it really went with the storylines of the other guys. They just kind of, I can't give it away.
You also have to remember too that, you know, Tarantino's lived in Hollywood most of his life. I mean, to me, this is kind of like
his love letter to Hollywood.
Well, yeah, and not just that too, but like, you know, like last year you had Alfonso Cuarón do Roma. That was kind of his love letter to his, you know, as he was growing up to Mexico. This is Tarantino's view of Hollywood as he's lived there.
Yeah,
so I see that as a very personal story, but it's also again, I feel like if he were the man behind Hollywood, I feel like this is how he would want it to be.
Yeah, this is all about his love for Hollywood and all its mystiques and all of its weirdness, you know? So the whole Charles Manson and Sharon Tate stuff is part of like this weird aspect of Hollywood. Right. And he chose a great time period, I felt, because, you know, it's 1969, right? So things are changing, times are changing. He makes a lot of fun of the hippies, right? And the hippie era.
Especially DiCaprio's character. Yeah.
With DiCaprio's character.
Hates hippies.
But I do agree, though, that the spark of this movie is DiCaprio and Pitt.
Oh, yeah.
And Pitt is my favorite character in the movie, although I think mm-hmm. DiCaprio has more moments to shine and more opportunities to show his range as an actor. I mean, there are some things that you laugh so hard watching him.
There's
you know?
Definitely more depth to DiCaprio's character. Brad Pitt, I thought, was very one-dimensional, but at the same time, he was more of like your upstanding character, kind of like the foil to DiCaprio.
Right.
So there's something to like from each one of those guys.
Yeah, definitely one is more selfless than the other, and I don't want to give too much away, but Pitt's character is funny, and he's a badass, man.
Well, I kind of felt DiCaprio definitely had the harder load as the actor.
Yes, absolutely.
Only because, you know, as someone who has been on movie sets before, I've worked in that industry, you know, the fact that he could remember to say line and ask for things, because yes, actors actually forget their lines a lot, and sometimes...
Yeah. No way!
No, they do. In fact, some of them even wear earwigs so that someone off stage will remind them of the line so they don't have to stop.
Yeah.
But back in the day, they couldn't do that, so the fact that when DiCaprio would mess up and we would see the camera go back to position one, all this kind of stuff, I'm like, oh man, that's a day at the office for me. I can totally understand, you know, what he's doing.
What he's going through,
but
yeah.
But I think as an actor, I think he definitely had the bigger challenge. Brad Pitt just had to be there and take his shirt off.
Be a tough guy.
No, he just had to take his shirt off on the roof and show off his abs, and you know. And I'm like, okay, that's not a challenge, man. Come on.
Yeah. Yeah.
Another cameo in this film is of course Kurt Russell who's
right.
worked with Tarantino before, but then all of a sudden he's also the narrator. So I'm almost kind of wondering if he's the other stunt guy who's saying, oh, let me tell you this crazy story that I once heard once upon a time in Hollywood. So
well,
I don't know.
And he could be giving him Tarantino could be giving himself a callback to, you know, Death Proof.
That is true, yeah.
Yeah.
As you know, Kurt Russell worked with Tarantino in Death Proof.
Yeah.
So, oh no, and not only that, Hateful Eight.
Hateful Eight as well.
Also in Hateful Eight.
Absolutely,
so,
yeah.
Who knows? Maybe Kurt Russell was the stunt double who became an actor.
But ultimately, guys, I enjoyed this movie and I would recommend it to be seen in the theater. I don't think it's a masterpiece, but I think it's a great film.
Mm-hmm.
And I really like what it has to say about Hollywood, that it's not this place that's magical all the time, that it's
right.
actually greed.
There's a seedy underbelly
to it.
There's
a seedy
yeah.
underbelly. It's gritty. It's not always fun. It's actually where dreams go to die a lot of the times, you know?
Right.
And I love this idea of how things are not permanent and things don't always go the way that you
right. And DiCaprio's
have them planned.
Yeah, yeah. Rick Dalton really embodied, you know, what Hollywood can do to you as far as bringing you up and maybe even tearing you down a little bit,
absolutely.
Right?
Absolutely. Yeah, yeah. Playing that has been actor, yeah.
It's all managing egos in Hollywood. That's all it is. You just have to learn how to cope with people like DiCaprio's, but DiCaprio himself, but Rick Dalton's. I should
right,
Dalton.
Right.
There are Daltons everywhere in life, and you just have to manage them and say, okay.
And what better scene to capture the balancing of egos than Bruce Lee's and Brad
okay.
Pitt's
oh,
scene?
Such a good
yes,
scene.
Yeah.
You know, I mean,
my
yeah.
hands have been registered as lethal weapons.
Exactly. Lethal weapons.
But, yeah, seriously, everybody, we do recommend you check out Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. And we do suggest you come to the Alamo Drafthouse because they are showing
yep.
in 35mm film.
That's
now,
right.
A lot of you guys may have never seen a movie in 35mm, but to us, people who grew up, you know, much younger than
you guys. It just gives it that classic look.
It gives it that classic
that
look and feel.
Yeah.
Yeah. So you will not miss out. And I loved it because there were certain parts of the movie where I'm like, ah, classic 35mm.
Yeah,
I love
definitely.
This.
Yeah. So as far as real ratings.
Sure. Okay. I'll go ahead and start out. Like I said, I didn't feel like this was a terrible movie, but not one of Tarantino's bests. So I'm going to go ahead and give it 4 reels out of 5, but to me, it's not quite a theater must-see. I would say it's in between that and maybe in between home viewing. But again, you know, that's me because of the pacing threw me off a little bit.
35 millimeter home viewing? Come on. You can't, no.
Well, not everyone's a theater aficionado.
Well, Carlos, what about you? What do you think?
I'm going to make a prediction. I'm going to predict this movie will be nominated for Best Picture.
I'm going to predict that it will be nominated for Best Picture as well. And I'm going to predict that Tarantino may get a directing nod as well.
I think Tarantino might either win writing or directing again, because this is a love letter to
Hollywood.
He's won writing before.
So maybe now.
Maybe directing this time, but this is the love letter to Hollywood. It's going to go to costumes, wardrobe, all that kind of stuff. Like, it will be nominated for a lot of the...
It's a big awards film for sure.
It's a big awards film. You will see it again soon. Yes. So
how many reels out of 5 would you give this movie?
I would give this 5 out of 5.
5 out of 5.
All right.
Mm-hmm. For us, that's like an instant classic rating.
Oh, it will. It will soon be a classic.
Yeah? Okay. He loved the movie. Yeah. All right. Well, I lie in between giving this movie 4.5 reels. I don't think it's quite a masterpiece. I definitely think that for me, you know, Inglourious Basterds, Pulp Fiction, there's still better films as far as the whole structure of the film, as far as the whole entire film. But this is definitely worth seeing, and I think you should check it out in the theaters for sure.
Of course, and at the Alamo Draft House on 35 millimeters. So again, don't forget everybody to comment in the section below for your chance to win 2 tickets to come to the Alamo Draft House to watch Once Upon a Time in Hollywood on 35 millimeter, the way Quentin Tarantino meant it to be.
Don't forget to look us up on social media. We're on Facebook at Real Screeners and Instagram, Real.Screeners. And if you enjoy our reviews, please don't forget to hit that subscribe and bell button.
Ding! So that does it for the Real Screeners. We want to thank Carlos Carrell again for being on the show with us.
Thank you, Carlos,
giving
for
us
being
his
on board.
Real take.
Appreciate it.
Of course. And don't forget to follow these guys at Real Screeners. And don't forget to visit your friendly neighborhood Alamo Draft House.
Rumor has it that Once Upon a Time in Hollywood... See, I can't even say Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. Did you catch that?
Dude, you haven't even said it once.
No, I did.
I know.
I totally screwed it up. All right, let's start again.
And hey, guys, stick around until the end of the video, and please comment for your chance to win 2 tickets to the Alamo Draft House.
Well, I partially disagree with what...
Then this swong is...
This swong? This swong.
Okay. Right,
it's ready? A swong.
Right, here we go. Then this one... Okay. 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 All right.